Guys, I just found this magazine from 1968. It's called Israel 20th Anniversary. This is 1968, 20 years after the war. With Russia rapidly rearming the Arabs, Israel marks its 20th anniversary, yearning for peace, but ready to unsheath the sword once again, if it has to. This is like a time capsule. A wall. Israeli soldiers left cheer their victories of June 1967. Premier Levi Eshkol, the great negotiator. Blood on the sand, can Israel survive another war? Israel's Arab neighbors. The Arabs, humbled in battle, now talk less about driving Israel into the sea. They search instead for a face-saving way of recovering their lost lands. Eesh. Seems like they didn't sheath that sword. More than 1.5 million impoverished Arab refugees have borne the brunt of the 20-year war, but they dream of massive retaliation and teach their children that Palestine is home. A divided city united, Jerusalem. It was like a great crazy county fair the day the Jerusalem Wall of Hate came tumbling down. Israelis now face the Herculean task of administering a city half Jewish and half Arab, half modern and half medieval, half cooperative and half hostile, but no one seems to mind. There is every belief that the ancient section of Jerusalem, formerly ruled by Jordan, can, with unflagging effort, be smoothly merged into the booming modern city that is the capital of Israel. For 20 years, ever since Israel's 1948 independence war, Jerusalem has been divided. In the west, the Israelis built a gleaming city of pinkish-yellow Jerusalem stone and the new Knesset building, the Kaira. Amazing to see. Would you guys like to see more of this? Should I read the whole thing for you one day? Everything is up to date, more or less. Israelis have the technical know-how to create complicated computers, turn deserts into gardens, and develop nuclear power. But in a rainstorm, their telephones stop working. Interesting stuff. That's just a piece of this book, guys. I can go through more. Israel the Beautiful. Oh my goodness, look at this. Look at those ruins. Ancient ruins throughout Israel stand as silent reminders of the three religions to whom this land is holy. Stately columns and beautiful mosaics of the 3rd century synagogue at Capernaum. It shows the influence of the Romans who occupied the land from 63 BC through AD 600s. Majestic granite columns called the Pillars of Solomon rise from the Negev in the region of Timnah, where King Solomon's workmen once mined copper. Mines in this area still yield large amounts of copper and manganese. Oh, this must be the Dead Sea. Look at all that salt. The Dead Sea is the world's lowest point and one of the hottest. Bathers can't sink in its salt-rich waters. Crystalline salt formations create strange patterns along the shore. Tradition says that one such pillar of salt is Lot's wife, who disobeyed God by turning back to watch the destruction of nearby Sodom. The Cascade of Tanur, right, one of the sources of the Jordan River, attracts nature-loving hikers and campers. Its waters flow southward into the Hula, a reclaimed marsh that is now wildfowl and migratory bird preserve. Nearest town to the Tanner is Dan, northernmost outpost of the ancient Israelite kingdom, and named after one of the 12 tribes of Israel. With the raging white hair of an Old Testament prophet, Israel's first prime minister holds a special place in his countrymen's hearts as the 20th century Moses, who led his people from bondage into the promised land. The Arab minority. This is just stunning stuff, guys. I never looked at it this close, but this is a magazine from 1968, and I think I should maybe go through more of it later.
What do you guys think? Should I read more from this magazine? A little time capsule. It's really a look back into the mindset in 1968 and what's going on in Israel today. I think it would be kind of interesting. Let me know what you think. Leave a comment below, share, and follow for more.